Americans, or many Americans, seem to be very intrigued by beauty. We have beauty contests. Did you know that? We have a beauty contest every year in Newman to see who Miss Newman is. We have beauty contests in California to see who Miss California is. We have beauty contests in America to see who Miss America is. And we even have the gall to have a beauty contest called Miss Universe. The Earth is only one little part of the universe, but we crown Miss Universe. Can you believe that, nerve? And somehow we get intrigued by physical beauty. And sometimes when a young man looks for his wife, physical beauty is the main point they look for. There's a problem with that. And the problem with that is that physical beauty doesn't last. We don't look as beautiful as we used to. I hate to admit it, but that's just the fact. I look at pictures of my graduation year and I cringe. Did I look like that? And do I look like this when I look in the mirror? Beauty is something that we're attracted to, but physical beauty doesn't last. Has anybody found that to be true? Well, today we want to conclude our study in the book of Proverbs. And I want to talk to you about Proverbs 31. Proverbs 31, verses 10 to 31. And I want to attack it from a different angle than I often have heard it addressed. Proverbs 31, verses 10 to 33, is often given or read on Mother's Day. And the pastor often gets up and says, "Ladies, I want to encourage you to be a Proverbs 31 woman." Have you ever heard that? Well, when I read this text, I see it from a different vantage point. I don't think that it is written to women for them to check to see how godly or ungodly they are. I think it is written to young men who are searching for a wife and encouraging them to not look at just physical beauty, but to look at spiritual character. That's the theme of the text. So if you're a woman here, relax. I'm not going to tell you 31 things that you ought to be. If you're a young man here, listen up, because I'm going to challenge you to think about who you look for in a wife. And if you look for the right person in the person that you choose for a wife, she might not be a beauty queen, but she might be the spiritual beauty that you need in your life. I want to address Proverbs 31, verses 10 to 33, and I want to tell you that it is a Hebrew alphabetical acrostic. There are 22 sentences in this text, and each sentence begins with the letter of the Hebrew alphabet. The problem is we can't translate it. But in since VBS is coming up, in VBS we do something that is a little bit of an acrostic. We say the ABCs of how to become a Christian. Do you remember what they are? You admit to God that you're a sinner. You believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sins, and you commit your life to him as Savior and Lord, or confess him as Savior and Lord. That's an acrostic, an ABC acrostic. Well, if you went, you know, in our alphabet, it's 26 letters, I think. If you went all the way from ABC and had a sentence for every letter, that would be equivalent to what they did in Hebrew. Only Hebrew has 22 letters, and they had a sentence for every letter, and this is a poem with that kind of an acrostic format or creation. And unfortunately, we can't see this in our English translation, but you can learn it from those who know Hebrew. And the context is that of a mother. Look back to chapter 31, verse 1. The sayings of King Lemuel, an inspired utterance his mother taught him. And we started that last week. We talked about verse 1 to 9. Now we're continuing and completing the chapter, verses 10 to 31. Listen while I read for you. A wife of noble character, who can find? She is worth far more than rubies. Her husband has full confidence in her and lacks nothing of value. She brings him good, not harm, all the days of her life. She selects wool and flax and works with eager hands. She is like the merchant ships, bringing her food from afar. She gets up while it is still night. She provides food for her family and portions for her female servants. She considers a field and buys it. Out of her earnings, she plants a vineyard. She sets about her work vigorously. Her arms are strong for her task. She sees that her trading is profitable, and her lamp does not go out at night. In her hand, she holds the distaff and grasps the spindle with her fingers. She opens her arms to the poor and extends her hands to the needy. When it snows, she has no fear for her household, for all of them are clothed in scarlet. She makes coverings for her bed. She is clothed in fine linen and purple. Her husband is respected at the city gate, where he takes his seat among the elders of the land. She makes linen garments and sells them, and supplies the merchants with sashes. She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on her tongue. She watches over the affairs of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children arise and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. Many women do noble things, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceptive, and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Honor her for all that her hands have done, and let her works bring her praise in the city gate. May God bless this reading of his word. I want to begin by saying that a good wife, and if you're looking for a good wife, listen carefully. A good wife has, number one, noble character. Noble character. This poem begins with a rhetorical question. Who can find a wife of noble character? And this question implies two things. First of all, it doesn't say that a wife of noble character is impossible to find. It simply implies that a wife of noble character is rare. So if you find a wife of noble character, you have found something extremely valuable. It is not impossible, but it is rare. A good wife is rare. And then in verses 10, the last part of verse 10 to verse 12, the poem has three statements, not only a rhetorical question, but also three statements. First of all, and I've already mentioned this, a good wife is valuable. Look at what the statement is. She is worth far more than rubies. Does anybody remember a statement about rubies earlier on in the book of Proverbs? When we were in Proverbs chapter 3 and verse 15, we read something, and it's amazing when you read all these chapters together and not separate from each other, then when you've read something and you hear the words again, you say, oh, I've heard that somewhere before. So when I read that this wife is worth far more than rubies, it reminded me of Proverbs 3, verse 15. And Proverbs 3 is talking about Lady Wisdom. And it says, she is more precious than rubies. So this woman that Lemuel's mom is telling him that he should be looking out for to possibly marry is a woman who is characterized by God's wisdom. So a good wife is rare, a good wife is valuable, and then a good wife is reliable. Look what it says. It talks about her husband. There are only three times when it talks about her husband, and this is the first one. Her husband has full confidence in her, and he lacks nothing of value. If you marry the right person, a person who has noble character, you can be totally confident in the way she will behave when you're not around. But if you marry somebody with questionable character, the trust level will not be there. And you'll be always wondering, what's she doing when I'm gone? And don't laugh at that. That's a serious question that some people wonder. So she is a good wife is reliable. And a good wife is also beneficial. She brings him good, not harm, all the days of his life. So these three sentences and the question all go into one main theme to say that a good wife has noble character. And before you say, I'm going to marry this girl because she's so pretty, you better think again and say, I'm going to marry the kind of girl that has the character that will keep us together for the rest of our lives. And by the way, if you want a girl of good character, you need to be a guy of good character. Because they attract each other, good character. So, a good wife has noble character. But then it's interesting that he goes back and forth, or she goes back and forth, because this is Lemuel's mom teaching him. She goes back and forth between the way that character is revealed or shown. Her character is displayed at home, and then her character is displayed in the community. And she goes back and forth between home and community, home and community, and then back home again. Look at verses 13 to 15. Her character is displayed at home. A good wife, verse 13, provides clothing. Excuse me. She selects wool and flax. She works with eager hands. You know what my wife does? I'm going to brag on my wife a little bit. You know what my bride does? While I'm driving on the vacation, she likes to sit and knit. And she bought some wool that was very cheap at a thrift store, and she sat and knitted a scarf to give somebody for wintertime. This is the kind of person that you want to look out for, somebody who's thinking ahead, thinking about taking care of others, and thinking about their clothing. That's what it says in verse 13. And then verses 14 and 15, a good wife provides meals. She is like the merchant ships that brings food from afar. This is picturing somebody who's going out to search for food. Maybe she's picking berries, or maybe she's doing other things to find food wherever it can be found. Maybe she's going to the grocery store nowadays. She brings food from afar. And it says she gets up early to provide food for her family. Many of the people who I've known who have been good bakers bake early in the day so that the bread has time to rise and all that other stuff. So she provides clothing and she provides meals. Then he talks about her character in the community, verses 16 to 20. A good wife makes wise purchases. Look at verse 16. She considers a field and buys it. She uses her earnings to plant a vineyard. This lady isn't just a stay-at-home mom. This lady is active in business in the community. She knows how to buy a field. She knows how to plant a vineyard. She's active in sales, and she's active in business in the community. And also verse 17, a good wife works hard. She works vigorously and has strong arms. Verse 18, a good wife knows how to make a profit. She sees that her trading is profitable and she stays up late. This is a hard-working lady. She gets up early and she stays up late. But not only does she know how to turn a profit, she's not a mean tycoon. Look at verse 19 and 20. A good wife knows how to be generous. And there's an interesting picture here that is kind of a comparison with what you do with your hands. She knows how to cling to the distaff. This is a picture of somebody who's spinning wool on a spinning wheel. She knows how to cling tight to something and grasp it when she is spinning, but she also knows how to open her arms to the poor. See, she's clinging tight on one picture, and the other picture, she's not clinging at all. She's opening her arms way open. She knows how to open her arms and extend her hands when she is with the poor and with the needy. She knows the balance of life. She knows when to cling on to something, and she knows when to let go of something. Do you see the value of her character that is being developed here? And then she goes back to, in verse 22, or 21 and 22, she goes back to the character at home. A good wife is well prepared. She has no fear of winter. Her household is warmly clothed. My wife had a kind of interesting experience because we got married here. She grew up here in California, and we got married here in California. And for the first 4 years about of our marriage, we lived here in California. But then during about the fifth year of our marriage, we moved to Steinbach, Manitoba, Canada. And this was the first time she figured out what winter was. And we had little girls. And I won't tell you which one, but one of our little girls had this thing that she didn't like to wear socks and shoes. And this little girl that didn't like to wear socks and shoes was tall enough, now you might figure out which one it was tall enough to grab the handle of the door. And before we knew it, this little girl was out the door in the snow in her bare feet. And Mom learned quickly how to go outside and make sure that girl didn't freeze her feet. But this lady that they're talking about had no fear in winter because the children were all dressed warmly, and my wife made sure that those kids were dressed warmly before they went outside. So this is the character of a wife being developed. She has no fear of winter. Her household is warmly clothed. And a good wife is also creative. She makes coverings for her bed and clothing for herself. This is a wonderfully well-balanced person. Then she goes back to the community, verse 23 and 24. Her husband is respected at the city gate. The first time I preached on Proverbs 31, I was dating my wife. And my father-in-law-to-be took me aside and told me that it wasn't very wise to preach on Proverbs 31. Because it was a very sexist chapter. The woman is working extremely hard, and the man is just sitting around. And he thought it was a disgraceful chapter. And I've read many others since then who don't like this chapter because of that. But I want to challenge our thinking a little bit. That's not accurate to the text. In the text, the man is sitting in the city gate, and we have lost an understanding for what the city gate is, unless you've been coming to Wednesday night and listening to our studies. There's a plug for Wednesday night, by the way. In our studies, we've learned that a city gate was used as the place for local government. It's the equivalent of saying that her husband was well respected and he was a counselor in the city council. The council met at the city gate, and that's where government matters were dealt with. This is a woman who has a husband who is well respected as a political leader in the city. It's not just that he sat around, you know, eating sunflower seeds. He was a respected city leader. He was a community elder. And she was active in city business. She made garments and she sold them. She's entrepreneurial, or if I can say that word. And she supplies merchants with sashes. These folks are well known in city business and city government. And then it goes back to the home, verse 25 to 27. A good wife is confident. She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She doesn't have to worry because God has developed the character of dignity in her life. She's not a slut. She's a dignified lady. A good woman or a good wife speaks with wisdom. Look what it says here. Faithful instruction is on her tongue. I taught my children the Bible and to love Jesus, but I owe a huge debt to my wife. My wife gave my daughters faithful instruction on a daily basis. And the reason they are faithful Christian young ladies today is because my wife was a faithful teacher of her children. That's the kind of woman you're looking for, guys. Not just pretty, not just pretty hair and pretty eyes and a pretty body. You're looking for a wife of noble character. That's what's being said here. Faithful instruction is on her tongue, and a good wife supervises her household, and she is not idle. A wife is the queen of the house. She's the one who's in control, and she supervises everything that's going on. So we've talked about her character at home, in the community, at home, in the community, and again at home. And then when you get to 28 to verse 31, you have a culmination of the poem. And it basically could be entitled, "A Good Wife is to be Praised." A good wife has noble character, and a good wife is to be praised. Her children call her blessed. Her husband praises her. And then I believe that it's exactly a statement that is quoted from this lady's husband. He says to her, "Many women do noble things, but you surpass them all." Isn't that a neat compliment from your husband? "Hey, babe, there are many good women out there, but you're the best." And if you can honestly say that to your wife, she's going to love it. And you're going to show her how much you love her. She is to be praised for a good reason, and that good reason is found in the front of your bulletin. It is not for her charm, because charm is deceptive. Have you ever been charmed into doing something that you wish you hadn't done? Charm is deceptive. It's not for her beauty. Beauty is fleeting. The years go by faster than you can shake a stick. Charm is deceptive. Beauty is fleeting. But then we get to the bottom line. But the woman who fears the Lord, that's the person who will be praised, is worthy of praise. And do you know what's going on here? Look at that verse very carefully. A woman who fears the Lord is to be praised, verse 30. And then go way back to the beginning of Proverbs, chapter 1 and verse 7, that I said was the theme of the whole book of Proverbs. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. So this woman that has been described here is a woman who fears the Lord. And that's the kind of man that Proverbs is trying to work on to create through the whole first 9 chapters. You should be a man who fears the Lord. And you should marry a woman who fears the Lord. And if you have a man who fears the Lord, marrying a woman who fears the Lord, you're going to have a family that fears the Lord. And you're going to have a family that is the best witness in society for the kingdom of God. That's what the church is designed to produce. Not just individual Christians who have no connection to anybody else in a family. The church is meant to produce a husband and a wife who both fear the Lord, who are bringing up children who fear the Lord, who are affecting families who learn to fear the Lord. And that's how a church grows, by having multiple partners in the family unit, father, mother, children, who all fear the Lord together. And then when you have multiple families that fear the Lord, then you can have a church family
that fears the Lord. And that's how God grows his community. It's beautiful. But it starts, guys, with the kind of person that you seek for in a wife. It is not charm, it is not beauty. It's a person who fears the Lord. She is to be praised in public. By the way, I've met many men who have a idea that it's funny to tease their wife or put their wife down in public. I remember a young man that I talked to very specifically on this topic. He came to our house, he had supper with us, and he tended to call his wife down. And I took him aside and I said, "My friend, you have a nice wife. Compliment her. Don't make fun of her. And especially not in public." And you know what? I say the same to everyone. If you have family members that you appreciate and love, don't talk bad about them in public. Talk about them with honor and respect and build them up publicly. Don't tear them down. And that will bring God's name honor. Honor her for what she has done. Her works bring her praise in the city gate. In fact, this woman is so well loved for what she does that City Hall hears about it and says, "This is the greatest mom in town." So we come to the end of the book of Proverbs. But remember, I skipped a whole bunch of Proverbs? It was because so many of those Proverbs are just individual sayings. But I found an individual saying that sums up chapter 31. And if you would turn with me to Proverbs chapter 18, I would like to read it in close of our summary of chapter 31. Proverbs chapter 18 and verse 22. This is what it says. "He who finds a wife finds what is good and receives favor from the Lord." Guys, if you're looking for a wife, or maybe you have one already, then you need to be thanking God for who you have. But if you're looking for a wife, look for one of noble character. And when you find one, praise God for her. And ladies, if you want to attract the right kind of a man, be the right kind of a woman who focuses on godly, noble character. You're beautiful just because God made you that way. Focus your efforts on noble character, and you will find the man who is looking for a woman of noble character. That's how God works. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for the book of Proverbs. Thank you, Lord, for how it instructs us in very, very practical ways, even to the point of who to look for when we're looking for a spouse. And I pray that you will help us, those in our congregation who are looking for a spouse, help us to look for a spouse in the right way by focusing on noble character and not just on physical features. And help us who are married to thank God for our spouses. and to focus on building each other up in our character and building up our children in their character so they in turn can find the right spouses. Thank you for the book of Proverbs and help us to be people of wisdom, because the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Help us to respect you with our hearts and our minds and our lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.